Good morning, and welcome to this edition of Worship Online. I'm the Reverend Glenda Whitehead, pastor of this wonderfully inclusive and affirming church we call Journey of Faith. If this is your first time to worship with us, we're glad that you're here. If you're one of our regulars, we're glad that you're here as well. And if you would, take a moment and check in on Facebook and let us know that you're with us. Before we begin worship, I have a couple of announcements. First of all, if you'd like to share your joys and concerns, please do so via our Facebook page, or you can email me at glenda@jofumc.org. This morning, I asked your prayers for the people along the Texas and Louisiana coast who are dealing with the aftermath of Hurricane Laura. I'd also like to invite you to make a donation to UMCOR, the United Methodist Committee on Relief. UMCOR is one of the best things the United Methodist Church does, and I know they are already on the ground in those areas devastated by this hurricane. Any contribution you make to UMCOR, 100% of what you give goes to aid on the ground. The overhead is paid by our church, and so unlike other organizations like the Red Cross, where about 40% of your donation goes to administration, 100% of what you donate to UMCOR goes to aid on the ground. So it's a wonderful organization. They do incredible work, and I commend them to you. You can either make a PayPal donation and just notate it, UMCOR, and we'll get it there, or if you want to send a check in and just put UMCOR on your check, we'll make sure it gets to the appropriate people. And while I'm on that, if you'd like to make a donation to Journey of Faith, you may do so via PayPal at jofumc@gmail.com, or you may also mail us a check at P.O. Box 1343, Round Rock, Texas 78680. As always, we are deeply grateful for your donations to our church. Your contributions allow us to continue this online ministry in these most unsettling times. Let us begin our worship this morning with a word of prayer. Be with us in this time of worship, O God. Center us in your presence. Surround us with your Holy Spirit. And open us to hear your word for us this day. We pray especially this day for the people along the Louisiana and Texas coast who've been hit hard by Hurricane Laura and for those who are responding to the devastation there. We pray too for our country as we are rocked again by more racial injustice and unrest. Help us to truly understand systemic racism and all the ways it plays out, and guide us as we seek to respond as best we can. Bless now our time together in each person who has joined us. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Son, for bear it is I, the God who called me here below will be forever mine, will be forever mine. You are forever mine.
This morning, we're going to be looking at a passage from the Gospel of Matthew. Over the last several weeks, we've been looking at stories of our faith in Genesis. And for the next several weeks going forward, we're going to be taking a trip through Matthew's Gospel and covering some of the important stories there. I want to begin with a story this morning. There's a story about a pompous young man who came to the great philosopher Socrates seeking wisdom and knowledge. Socrates immediately recognized that this young man was indeed proud and arrogant. But the philosopher led the boy through the streets and into the sea until they were both chest deep in water. Then Socrates asked him, "What do you want?" "Wisdom and knowledge, O wise Socrates," said the young man with a smile. Socrates pushed the young man under the water and led him up 30 seconds later. He asked him again, "What do you want?" "Wisdom and knowledge," the young man choked out. Again, Socrates shoved his head back under the water and led him up 40 seconds later. By this time, the young man was gasping for air And Socrates asked him, "Now tell me, what do you want, young man?" Socrates and the young man went through a third round of this same scenario. Finally, Socrates asked the young man what he wanted, and the boy screeched, "Air! I need air!" The wise Socrates then said to him, "When you want wisdom and knowledge, as you have just wanted air, then you will have it." Our scripture lesson is from Matthew 14, verses 22 through 33, from the Common English Bible. "Right then, Jesus made the disciples get into the boat and go ahead to the other side of the lake while he dismissed the crowds. When he sent them away, he went up onto a mountain by himself to pray. Evening came, and he was alone. Meanwhile, the boat, fighting a strong headwind, was being battered by the waves and was already far from land. Very early in the morning, he came to his disciples walking on the lake. When the disciples saw him walking on the lake, they were terrified and said, 'It's a ghost.' They were so frightened, they screamed. Just then, Jesus spoke to them, 'Be encouraged. It's me. Don't be afraid.' Peter replied, 'Lord, if it's you, order me to come to you on the water.' And Jesus said, 'Come.' Then Peter got out of the boat and was walking on the water toward Jesus. But when Peter saw the strong wind, he became frightened. As he began to sink, he shouted, 'Lord, rescue me.' Jesus immediately reached out and grabbed him, saying, 'You man of little faith, why did you begin to have doubts?' When they got into the boat, the wind settled down. Then those in the boat worshiped Jesus and said, 'You must be God's son.'" This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. I wonder if perhaps similar words were exchanged between Jesus and Peter as between Socrates and the young man that came to him. "What do you want, Peter?" "Faith, Lord. I want to walk on water just like you. I want to be with you, to follow you, to serve God in the same self-giving, risk-taking way that you do, Jesus." And as Jesus pulled him up, "What do you want?" "Faith." "What?" "Air." "When you want to follow me, to serve God, when you want faith as much as you wanted air just now, then you will have it." Let's back up and remember what's going on here in this story. Jesus had intended to have a little time away, a respite with his disciples away from the crowds who had been demanding their attention, needing this and that, a healing, a word of hope, a reminder of God's forgiveness and grace. And just as they tried to take their mini vacation, a crowd gathered for a lesson and a lunch. Jesus has just fed the multitude, and he's finally ready to pray and rest. He needs some alone time, just him and God. He needs to be recharged, to get refocused. So he sends the disciples on ahead of him to the other side of the lake. Notice that scripture says he made them get in the boat. That word is probably better translated, compelled them. I wonder if the fishermen in the group were reading the skies. Red sky at morning, sailor take warning. Maybe they knew enough to know that the conditions were right for a storm to blow up on that lake, and the last thing they wanted was to be caught out in it. But Jesus forced them. After all, if they were going to be followers of Jesus, if they were going to go with him to Jerusalem, to the garden, to the cross, they'd better learn it was going to involve taking some risk. They'd have to learn that even when it seemed the waves were going to overcome them, that Jesus would be there. Whatever happened in the days to come, God was going to show them wondrous, miraculous things. And as we too journey with Jesus, we'd best learn those same things. You know, there will come a time in each of our lives when we find ourselves in the midst of a storm. It's just a fact of life. Storms come. The waters get rough. we get tossed to and fro. Consider this pandemic. Few of us were prepared for what it would bring. And so we feel we're being battered by wind and waves, rowing for all we're worth, and just getting nowhere. Many times in life, it seems that no matter how hard you try, you just can't get ahead. You work and work, but you still can't get all the bills paid. You've talked until you're blue in the face, but you can't seem to get the other one to hear you. You've been in program after program, but you can't seem to break the addiction. You've been to one expert after another, but the problem won't go away. The pain won't stop. The relationship never seems to get better. The wind is against you, and your efforts seem fruitless. It's dark, and it's scary, and we're weary from the ceaseless turmoil. And just when it seems things can't get any worse, here comes a ghost. Take heart, it is I, Jesus says. Where the waves are pounding and the storm is raging, there's Jesus. Not in the safety of the boat, not now, not yet. No, Jesus is there in the thick of it, in the middle of that tempest that seems about to do you in. So if you want to be with Jesus, you have to do what Peter did and get out of the boat. How often we hear Peter criticized. Man of little faith, took his eyes off Jesus, sank like a rock. But hear again what Jesus says to him. Oh, little faith, why did you doubt? You see, Jesus isn't rebuking Peter for trying. He doesn't say to him, what were you thinking? Rocks sink in water. Why in the world did you get out of that boat? No. Instead, he's telling him that if he had just stayed focused, he could have probably walked with Jesus all the way across that lake. You see, I don't think the Lord is ever disappointed with us for trying to be like him. I don't think we have to apologize for our failures as long as we're trying to walk with Jesus. But to sit in the boat clutching tightly to the sides means we may never seek faith as much as a drowning person seeks air. Peter teaches us that a healthy faith often takes risk and leads us into territory that is outside our comfort zone. Maybe that means you say to your pastor, you know, I want to tell my story. I want to testify about what my God is doing for me. Yes, it will be the most uncomfortable thing I've ever done, but you know, I want to do it. Maybe it means you say, put me down to teach a Sunday school class via Zoom or to lead an online Bible study. Or maybe you're being asked to be a part of our online praise team, to record yourself playing or singing, to add your voice to our Sunday morning worship. Yes, it's weird, and it's difficult, and maybe a bit risky, but what a difference it makes to our Sunday morning experience. Or perhaps stepping out for you means inviting your friends or your neighbors to check out our online service. Or maybe you have an idea for a mission opportunity that we can actually participate in, even in the midst of COVID-19. Or you're being called to help get all the protocols set up and staffed once we return to in-person worship, as risky as that may seem. You know, I know it's hard to think of ways to step out of the boat in the midst of a pandemic when things are so out of kilter. But still, maybe if we listen, really listen, God is calling us to do just that. Perhaps you're aware that the sanctuary of the church is called the nave. It comes from the Latin and Greek words for ship. Are we to just sit here in our boat, our ship, while Jesus is walking out there amidst the storms of life? Or is God calling us to something new, something more? Are you comfortable just doing what we're doing? Or are you someone who says, you know, I want to do that. I want to step out in faith and know that God will be with me. I may sink, my plan may fail, but that won't be the end. We know that Peter didn't walk on water for very long, but Scripture says that he did walk on water. I can't help but wonder what life is like if you possess the knowledge that you walked on water with Jesus. What couldn't you do? What couldn't you face? How could you fear that God might desert and abandon you? Can you imagine how different the story might have been if it wasn't just Peter, but all 12 of those disciples who stepped out and kicked at the waves, who ran atop the spray, who danced in the wind that night with Jesus? How formidable would a cross appear when you know the God that who can make anything possible? And how might a congregation react when we hear somebody in our midst say, you know, I have this crazy idea, and I'd like you to join me. You see, Jesus is out there. So what if? What if we all stepped out there? Will we ever want Jesus as much as we want air? Thanks be to God. Amen.
Abounds in deepest waters, your sovereign hand will be my guide. My fear may fail and fear surrounds me, you've never failed, and you won't start now. Presence of my Savior, and I will call upon your name and keep my eyes above the waves. When oceans rise, my soul will rest in your embrace, for I am yours and you.
Thank you again for tuning in with us this morning. We are so glad that you were here. We miss you terribly, and we're looking forward to opportunities when we'll again be able to worship in person, even if that's just outside once a month. Stay tuned for more information about that possibility. Now go forth in peace, and may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of God's Holy Spirit be with you, now and forever. Amen.